Quit tripping. After party. The bounce back.
Hey, hey.
You thought you knew Stanley Havili? You don't know Stanley Havili. You don't know him? Well, actually, you do now.
You do now.
You do now. See, you thought he was just juking people, making one-handed grabs. Making one-handed grabs, running people over. That dude, that's, man, he's got no fear. He's taking on those linebackers coming head-on. Come to find out, oh, we all got fear. Just some people were scared of the big dude across, all juiced up, all jacked up, all muscled out. Stanley wasn't afraid of that dude. He's afraid of the dude in the mirror, right? And the way you broke it down on our radio show, man, we had to take a little time from the after party just to get even more real and talk about it. Right. Man, so hopefully if you haven't listened to the radio show and you're just turning on the Quit Trip and After Party, go back and listen to the radio show first. Otherwise, a lot of this ain't going to make sense. But I just want to get a couple thoughts and feelings now from people that were here in the room with us.
Right.
Feecy, let's go with you first, man. You've obviously known Stanley for a long time, right? Obviously, been a part of his life, especially recently with everything that he's got going on in his life. What were some things that stood out to you tonight that you definitely felt? Because I saw that you're feeling it, but some things that are just like, man, like you were just connecting with, maybe things you're just proud of them. Because I mean, I know that a lot was going through your head,
right? And so, you know, just as a counselor in the field as well.
Yeah. So just let people know. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I've been doing this for about 15 plus years, and in regards to helping individuals and families and also couples dealing with addiction, all types of addictions, and especially the pornography stuff. You know, that's where you know, my background and specialization comes from. And you know, just being able to disclose, you know, what he just shared is huge for our people. You know, I'm talking about the Pacific Island people, but even athletes in general, because again, there's that layer, that facade that we cover up, that, you know, as he mentioned, it's just, you know, I'm not gonna share this stuff. This is not gonna be broadcasted or disclosed to people. And that's not me. This is me.
Yeah, like Stanley was saying, like, that's the one he wanted to take to the grave.
and most people would.
Yeah.
You know? But in order for someone to really start that change process, they've got to be just genuine and blunt and honest about, you know, what's in the closet.
Well, haven't you sat there as a counselor just wishing that someone of a high influence, someone that, like, pro athlete, something like that, because you know dudes are struggling with this kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Right? From addictions to, from whether it be actual drugs, street drugs, alcohol, pornography. Man, pornography is just the easiest one that no one talks about, but that means that there's a lot more people struggling than we even know, right?
Yeah.
So, Feecy, sitting there as a counselor, haven't you always just been waiting for someone like Stanley to come around to be like that first one that presses the play button and says, we're going to talk about this?
No, definitely. And you know, I also work in with Pacific Islanders, and it's difficult even to disclose the fact that you have mental health issues.
Oh yeah.
But then to come out and say that there's an issue with pornography and, you know, other types of, you know, addictive behavior is just unheard of. And so it's now changing within that community because there's a voice. There are voices. Stanley's one of them. And there are a few other that are coming to the surface, and it's been a huge opportunity for people to be vulnerable again. And I love what I do, because I can see when people come in with that humility and that willingness to want to change, and to see them go from point A, you know, and go through the A, B, C, D, E, all the way through hopefully Z. I mean, life continues on.
Yeah.
And the reality of ongoing recovery is there's a possibility that we may slip up in the future because of some trigger that we were not prepared to, you know, to deal with. But like you said, Stan, you get back up, you learn from that mistake or that trigger, and you change things and adapt and go forward. You evolve and you morph. You use the word morph, I think I heard earlier in this broadcast. So,
well, yeah, you got to evolve, because you don't evolve, you die.
Right.
Like, in real life, like, if we don't learn how to, like, fight off that one lion that's killing everybody, the village ain't going to live. Right. You know what I mean? And obviously, in this case, you know, a lot of times nowadays, with, we don't have to fight for food and shelter like we used to, the lion's really inside of ourselves now, mm-hmm. right? Can we control our desires? Can we look at our past experiences and get something from them to make sure we don't make the same mistake, mm-hmm. right? And I want to ask you too real quick, Ken, because mm-hmm. I know just getting out of playing football at the University of Utah, being mm-hmm. around, when you're around those locker rooms with boys, you hear stuff,
yeah.
talk stuff like that. How important do you think, how big is it, do you think, to have an athlete like Stanley, and we're talking mostly specifically about the pornography one, because that's just the huge one right now, man. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the one that's like, dang, that's out of control, right?
Yeah.
And it's so shameful. It's like, I said on a podcast before that we had, it's the one thing when I'm counseling people that, like, at least with drugs, you can go do it with other people, yeah. right? You can call someone to get it, right? Mm-hmm. And so the more isolated you are, you know, the strength in numbers, well, there's weakness in isolation. Mm-hmm. So the more you're alone doing anything shameful, the more taboo it is.
Right.
It's going to be harder to, like, you get this drug, this high from looking at it, and then you go and hang around people and you can't share that high. Or you can't talk about that high.
The shame.
Yeah, so the shame is like, it's like this weird replacement. You feel really high, you feel really horrible. There's no in between, right? So for you right now, for young men, like, that possibly could be listening to this, or even young women too, mm-hmm. and young people in general, why do you think this is important to have someone like Stanley right now talk so openly about these sorts of things?
Just like what was said before about, you know, a lot of people are ashamed of even saying they watch it or, you know, take part in it. Because I know, like, you know, at my job, there's some people that actually do it, like the adult film, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? So just seeing them, they feel like they're ashamed of what people would think of them. And from, you know, when I've, you know, been realizing and hearing tonight, man, it's nothing to be ashamed about. You know, everybody struggles with something. And I didn't want to cut him off earlier because I was like, because I wanted to hear everything, but not to go away from the pornography part, but I just wanted to, because when he was talking to me about, so I had talked to my dad a couple days ago, and it seemed like everything that he said about his drug addictions and how he viewed it himself, I'm thinking about my dad when we was talking, and hearing him speak was just like how my dad was saying. Like, it was weird. And because my dad, he was dealing with drugs, going in and out of jail. You know, it wasn't really in my life that much because of those problems. And everybody looked at him as like, what's his, like, you know, and like backing away from him, and he felt isolated. And ever since he started being vulnerable with me, like, things are starting to get better. I remember when he said something about, he went to the gym, asked somebody, how can he get clean? He was like, find God. And I started laughing because that's the same thing my dad did. Like, he went and found God, and like literally a couple of days ago, he was like, son, I've been clean. I've been going to church. You know, God has really been helping me and helping me with this situation. And like hearing him say this, I'm like, wow, that's crazy. I just literally had this conversation with my dad like a couple of days ago. And it seemed like everything that he said tonight, like, really resonated with me. I'm like, dang,
you're feeling it from a son perspective.
Right.
Because it makes sense. When he was talking about, and I was going to ask you this too, is when he's talking about, like, when you hear a dad say, I wasn't even thinking about my kids.
Right.
On the outside, just by a quick analogy, like, oh, wait, he didn't care about his kids? Mm-hmm. But that's not what you were saying at all.
Exactly.
The point is that, like, you almost, the people that could influence you to see self, the people mm-hmm. that could influence you to feel, you have to block them out. Because mm-hmm. if you don't block them out, they're going to get to you. Mm-hmm. If you start looking at your kids' eyes, and mm-hmm. so maybe it helps you, Kenneth. Well, I don't know. Does it help you to think, like, man, my dad wasn't rejecting me. He wasn't abandoning me.
Exactly.
I was just a reflection of him, and he couldn't mm-hmm. even look at the mirror. So how the heck is he supposed to look at me?
Exactly. So when he was talking, it seemed like he was talking for my dad. It was weird, the connection that I felt when he was talking about it, because I felt like, wow, like, I didn't think of it in that way. Like, from his perspective, like, I'm thinking, like, he's just abandoned me and stuff like that because he didn't, you know, didn't want to be in my life and stuff like that. But I didn't realize his demons that he had to face with. You know what I mean?
He didn't want to infect you.
Exactly. And hearing him, I'm like, dang, that's basically my dad talking. Like, it's weird how you were saying, you know, everything happens for a reason. And it's weird how you said your wife was your lifeline to, you know, to not commit that suicide. And I feel like my dad always tells me, son, you're the only reason why I didn't kill myself. And I felt like I was his lifeline to not doing that. And I'm like, hearing you, man, it was just like, dang, that is so crazy, man. It's like, it's so weird. It's like, dang.
So what does it make you think, Stanley, when you're hearing him from a son perspective talk about, like, because, you know, obviously his was the dad, him connecting with you right now. What does that make you think?
It humbles me, and I'm grateful today that today my son won't know that life, he won't know that dad, and that I have an opportunity today to be a part of my son's life and to coach him.
Because you would never want that adult conversation, huh?
No.
With your son, like, apologizing to, like, he's looking at you, where were you?
Yeah, and I remember, you know, the lie that I had in my head, and it was truth at the time, that I needed pills to be a good father. And that's what I thought. And it wasn't, you know, I wasn't abandoning my son. I knew I needed this to take him to the park, to take him to Lagoon, to take him out of the house, because if I didn't have this, I was withdrawing.
Yeah.
So it's humbling today to know, like, I talk about it to my wife, like, I'm grateful that my kids won't remember this, you know, of me in a hotel, you know, hiding, putting the pills up on the fridge so they couldn't reach it. Yeah. You know, stuff like that, little things like that, I'm grateful for.
Well, why do you think right now, and this is, like I said, because we're not on the radio show now, we can just talk, like, why do you think right now, I mean, Feecy and I both, you know, we counsel young people, right? The drugs, pornography, and stuff like that. What do you think are some of the things right now that you see that are happening that's making it difficult for this generation, even more so than it was 10 years ago when you were going through your stuff?
I think that the biggest thing is the access. You know, I had to walk.
That's a good point.
You know, I had to walk
That sleepover.
Yeah, I had to plan the sleepover. We got our group together, you know, but today it's like, you have it in your room. You don't have to go to your friend's house. You know what I mean? The triggers that come are easy now because you have social media, Instagram. You know, there's some pretty bad videos that can get you to a point where, all right, I want to go isolate. You know what I mean?
Yep.
The access, I think, is the biggest issue I think the younger kids are going to have to face. You know, when I was in college, my little brother had a cell phone. I didn't have a cell phone until college. And now it's like my nieces and nephews have cell phones, and they're in elementary. And that's the scary part.
I was going to say, does that scare you, especially for, I mean, I've got young kids coming up, but knowing how our brains and our bodies work, is that scary for you?
Yeah, super scary. Super scary. And I know now it's, and looking back in my life, I'm not going to be able to prevent my daughter or son from being exposed to anything.
There's no way.
But I can strengthen my relationship with them and their self-worth and let them know that they're loved no matter what, and that they can come to me because I've been there, you know, and I get it, and there's no judgment.
How hard do you think, and Feecy, you might be able to weigh on this too, not might be able to, know you can, how think you hard it is? Because, okay, so for example, we're talking about, you know, the Polynesian culture, right? Mm-hmm. It's very similar in certain, you know, like Latino cultures, like, you know, we have a lot in common. Certain cultural norms are not really fostering vulnerability and talking. And so what I see is happening is we have to, like, bridge this gap from the old school to the new school, and it's our generation that's in the middle. Mm-hmm. Like, we have to be able to connect the dots. How do we hold on to the culture, the things of the culture that need to be kept, the traditions, right? But then again, how do we evolve right now we can actually create real life situations and solutions for the kids today? Because we can't take the old school versions of how they dealt with stuff and apply it to today. It just doesn't work.
No, it doesn't work. You know, it's so difficult, that transition of, you know, coming and being a Tongan and living in the islands and coming here and adapting to becoming an American. I mean, there's so much exposure to just a different way.
Oh, yeah.
You're conditioned a certain way to be.
It's like you're in the Jetsons. Right. Like, you went to, like, outer space.
Exactly.
Like,
you know, so you're conditioned, and your parents are trying to maintain those core values of what it means to be a Tongan.
Yeah.
And then once you leave that door, you're then getting told or conditioned in a different way. This is what an American is, or this is what, you know, a guy does or a girl does. And so it becomes a strained dynamic. Or this paradigm for them, and it's confusing.
Yeah,
and so they're evolving, and a lot of times because of that distance, and I would say it's very difficult for Polynesians to get on an emotional level with their children because there is that level of respect. And so it's very,
well, respect is always seen like, right, you have to not say anything to show respect.
When you know, and so there's not that opportunity to be vulnerable or to talk about, you know, what's going on in my life.
Can't practice.
Exactly. and so that's where the change has to occur, is there's got to be a connection with their children on that level, or else they'll continue to delve into these behaviors that get them caught up and bound, and they're going to get stuck. And that's what we've, that's what I've found. And, you know, as I've continued to talk with some of the Pacific Island leaders in the church, I've come to realize that, you know, that it's a challenge for them to come forward still. And
this is a work in progress. This is something we have to create right now in this time. Because as you're saying those things, I'm thinking of Stanley, I know it's just an idea. Like, okay, I got to make sure my kids have self-worth. I got to make sure I have these things. Mm-hmm. And I got to make sure I got to keep the dialogue open.
That's it.
But who do you think is going to you have to model that for them.
Yes.
Right? So, like, have you ever had those scenarios like, man, okay, let's say I come home. Say I catch my son looking at something.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, I think about the stuff. I wish I could turn my brain off, man. I'm like, man, I know too much. Yeah. I need to stop thinking, right? And it's like the natural response might be like, fuss him, you know, hit him, or, you know, like, roll or get mad at him, whatever. But, like, how do you picture yourself in that situation? How do you want to handle that? What do you think would be the helpful, supportive, best way to handle the situation based upon your experience?
Man. Just to sit down and the best way is just to sit down and talk to him, you know, and if he's not willing to talk, tell him I'm here, you know, not forcing him to tell me anything or forcing him to a situation where he's uncomfortable.
Not posturing over him, like looking like you're going to beat him up or something like that.
Yeah, definitely.
And that's the hardest one to control.
That is.
That's because we don't have a video camera knowing what we look like. We could be like, what are you doing? And in our minds, we're like, I'm scared of you being like me. Like, what are you doing? And all I hear is like, oh my gosh, I'm about to get lickings. I'm about to get beat. Like, I'm in trouble. When you're like, no, I'm actually concerned, but it looks like you're angry.
Exactly. I don't know. I have a lot of room to grow. And you know, I don't think going through the scenario right now, my reaction wouldn't be what I want it to be.
Yeah.
So.
You need some time.
Yeah, I need some time to learn how to control my emotions.
Well, because think about it. How scared, I mean, okay, so what's your son's name again?
Hinkley.
This is your mini-me. Yeah. This is your, I mean, like, the last thing I've never met a parent says, I want my kid to be just like me. That's insane. You want your kids to be just like you. You want them to cut the corner, you know what I mean, get there a whole lot sooner. So it's like you just want the best for them, right? Yeah. And but if he has any manifestation of attributes like you, it's because he's your son, and that's scary.
Yeah.
I told my wife when, you know, like, so I only have, you know, I have one boy, a daughter, and a son. And just to kind of bring the whole entire father-oldest-son relationship to life, we've talked about this in other podcasts before, but I think it's really relevant to this conversation right now, is that father-oldest-son relationship's a trip, man. Mm-hmm. It's really, it's like the oldest son is half parent, half child. They're asked to do things like a parent their whole entire life, but at the same time, they're still a child, right? And so they have this weird connection specifically with the same-sex parent. It's called the symbiotic relationship, right? They feel what the other person feels. And so with me and my son, it's like the whole entire time I found out I was having a son, I was excited, and I started having anxiety attacks all the time, like for 6 months straight. I was like looking for counselors to go see. I was like writing in my journals. Like I was struggling. Well, it was obvious to me as I kind of did all my soul search. It was like, I didn't know who my biological dad was. Everybody tells you, oh, you're going to be such a great father because certain attributes. And you're like, really? You sure about that? Because I don't know if I'm going to be a great father. Like, you know, the jury's out on that one, right? And so when you look at your son, you want him to be everything that you possibly are going towards, but you want him to get there sooner to save him that hurt and pain.
Yeah.
But to watch our kids do something that creates hurt and pain for them, it creates hurt and pain for us, that's the hard part not to react to.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I know the path that you're on right now is going to get you that point. How old's Hinkley?
Two.
Good. My Tavita's two also, man.
Yeah.
Oh, Tavita play whiteout, your son play halfback. but you get what I'm saying, though,
I do.
In regards, like, how often do you think of him right now?
A lot. You know, I think of my kids all the time and this world that they're coming up in.
Is this part of the reason, maybe the motivation to do things like this, not just for helping self, but like, man, if I could make some sort of impact or influence?
Not really. I think doing stuff like this has made me evolve and have to grow and want to be a better person. And in return, I'm a better father. And because I'm growing and I'm learning more about myself. I think it's just, you know, with doing this is the payoff. is I'm going to be there for my kids. I'm going to be able to be more empathetic and love them regardless of the situation.
It's kind of like going to play at USC or the NFL where everybody's 4 or 5-star recruits.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's like it puts you in a situation to step your game up, to see what you're really worth and really what you're capable of.
And that's the thing about, you know, sports. I mean, there's the positive aspects of being on a team and learning, you know, that camaraderie and that closeness with brotherhood and stuff like that. But your worth and your value gets wrapped around your ability to perform. And I talked to this with Stanley, you know, before about, you know, I did some interviews with some previous professional athletes, and they talked about, you know, worshiping these monuments that they've grown up, you know, starting to believe about themselves. And so when that's taken away, either, you know, they're after their college career or when their NFL career is taken away because of, you know, retirement or whatever it is, where does that value then lie, or that worth? They have to find it. And that's where it's so easy to delve into, you know, behaviors that become addictive because, I mean, I don't have that worth and value anymore. I don't have the light shining on me on Sundays. And so it's a journey, and it's a very difficult process, and, you know, of trying to find out who they are. And that goes for anyone else, whether it's being a professional in any arena of life, businessman, you know, school teacher, whatever it is, you get to that place where your performance overrides your core worth and value, which is already there, and it's already established because of who you are as a human being. And
your value, you're only as good as your last performance.
Exactly.
So you got to keep up. You got to keep it up.
But you see it too. I mean, we've all experienced this, you know, through Little League. You're the star. You get the props, and you get all the reinforcements of, oh, I'm good, I'm this, I'm that.
The false sense of security,
right,
without a doubt.
And you start to believe it, and you internalize it, and that is just starting down that path or that road towards dysfunction. And, you know.
Well, and like Stanley said, it only gives you more reason to keep those masks up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
Because it's not like, you know, someone else gets in trouble with drugs. It's like, okay, if you get in trouble with drugs, it's in the newspaper. Mm-hmm. It's on TV.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, okay, I better have a really good mask, not a, because we all got masks. We got different things we put on. You know, and as you're talking about that, oh, man, I want to ask you, Stan, I don't know how much this person has influenced you. I don't know how much you thought about it. But, you know, being a having this connection with Junior Seau, both going to USC, growing up, Polynesian people were influenced by him in one way, shape, or form, some greater than others. I was wondering, did you ever meet Junior? Did you have any thoughts on him? Was there any sort of connection that you've ever had with him, even if it wasn't like a personal friendship connection? And if you could just talk about that for a second, because I was curious about that day, because when I was talking, wearing his jersey, I was looking at you. When I looked at Alema and I looked at you, I'm like, man, there must be something there. And then Alema showed me a picture of him and Junior later and told me, I'm like, I could tell Alema had, you know, you don't have to know someone for long to have a connection with them, right?
Yeah. Well, I've never met Junior personally.
Yeah.
But, you know, being at SC and him being a football player in general that's Polynesian.
Yeah.
Him being the
Polynesian of all Polynesians.
Yeah, the trailblazer. Right? And then going to SC and seeing Junior's picture everywhere, you know, and understanding this is what I have to live up to.
Yeah.
The Polynesian what I as a Polynesian has to live up to, this him and Troy.
Yep.
You know, these two people before I got there and just the stories that I've heard of him and while I was there, while he was playing, how he handled himself not only as a professional but as a person.
Mm.
You know, and that just spoke and echoed, you know, how I wanted to act as a professional and as a person. He was so personable. Easy to talk to, right? And that's what I heard. And I had a lot of coaches that I played for that knew him very closely. And when he had passed, I was at SC. And that was, you know,
that was a blow to the community.
Community, because he was just at our spring game, you know, not a couple months before. And we were all in shock, you know. But like you said, if he was here today, he would be at the front of this, you know, becoming vulnerable and being willing to tell everyone.
You know, I'm so thankful that you said that, because here it is, like, we're talking about in complete admiration of a person who passed away from suicide, but that's a person we want to be like.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the sense, because obviously that's not who he was, mm-hmm. right? Like that, you know, that's some, a whole bad series of events, from the CTE right. to everything he went through to, you know, and once again, you know, he's the super Samoan. Mm-hmm. Like he's the ultimate, like he was the ultimate example of being too strong.
Mm-hmm.
Look at his NFL career. How many people, you know, played 20 years in the NFL and was just like, and he was the hammer, not the nail. You know,
exactly.
Like he was hammering plenty of dudes. Right. And then you see how, you know, the legacy and everything. And then you see like what happened, but you can look at him as like, man, he was a blueprint of how to live his life in so many other ways though.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what I think is great about, you know, someone like him is like, he can be an example of living a great life, but at the same time, the need to being vulnerable.
Exactly.
Because I don't know what exactly he was going through, but mm-hmm. he could have benefited. Because you hear all the interviews afterwards, people like, he wouldn't open up. He wouldn't open up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that, you know, we, as being in the, you know, in the profession, we understand that frontal cortex, if it's damaged over time, their ability to reason and understand logic, consequences, costs, I mean, compulsivity, impulsivity, that kind of thing, is what becomes part of their personality.
And if anyone's ever got a bag, you've had some concussions in your mm-hmm. day. A lot of people that don't have concussions don't realize how emotionally unstable you are after a concussion. Like after a concussion, I mean, you could be crying over some weird stuff and people are like, what's going on? I mean, you're you're not vulnerable in the helpful, progressive way. You're mm-hmm. vulnerable in the what's going on with me type of way, let alone stringing, you know, I can't imagine playing for 20 years in the NFL, lowering your head, knocking dudes out.
Exactly.
I mean, he probably had more concussions than anyone of all time. You know what I mean? And probably woke up, hit some smelling salts, I'm good,
mm-hmm.
and just beasted it out and just kept on going, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, I just had to ask you about that because, man, I know for me being a local boy from the same area as Junior, and, you know, my dad was a chiropractor, and my uncle was like his personal bodyguard, and my brothers played in the NFL. They're a little bit older than him. He used to say, idolized, because they were the only other local guys that were in the NFL. Like, you know, he was just like such a big fan of the game and such a like energetic, bubbly mm-hmm. guy.
Yeah.
And I don't know, man. He's just one of those people where like he's affected my life. Even though I was just younger looking up to him, I didn't really know him that well.
Yeah.
But like he's one of those dudes that I want to be like too.
Mm-hmm.
Real quick, before we wrap it up here at the Quit Trippin' After Party.
Mm-hmm.
I got to ask you about something about family, man.
Yeah.
I know it's pretty well known that, you know, Polynesians, you know, traditionally have a very close connection and, you know, tightness with their family. And you talked about your family, you know, a lot tonight, right? You talked about, you know, your wife and, you know, it was those boundaries that she laid that basically something had to happen.
Yeah.
Because if she never laid those boundaries, we wouldn't be here having this conversation.
No.
Right? Like that, you know. Mm-hmm. You might still be chasing that dragon.
I would be.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, you know, that story wouldn't be done yet. But when you look at your wife, because obviously your wife is Polynesian, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, for those listening, you know, she's white. But I think the spirit of Polynesian spirit and, you know, the pride and, you know, and just being a strong, assertive person, I think that is the ultimate of what Polynesian women, Polynesian people, and other ethnic backgrounds, that's what we want to be. But sometimes the opportunity presents itself and we just can't be that at the moment.
Yeah.
Right. So looking back at all the stuff you've been through, if you could just weigh in really quickly as far as like the influence, like your parents and your immediate family. And then lastly, you know, we'll go out on the podcast, like you just sharing some real thoughts and feelings about your wife. Cause when you're talking about your wife, I'm like, man, your wife and my wife, they're probably pretty similar because my wife don't play.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, I married a Polynesian girl too. I'm like, man, I don't want to marry no Polynesian girl. Get my butt whooped, you know, like, you know, at home, I get beaten at home. And next thing I'm like, man, this 5'2" girl, I'm scared to death of her.
Yeah.
Right. So talk about your family first and then about your wife.
Man, I talked to Fisi before about this. My family is amazing. But the barriers that we've had to pass through, is communication. You know, as a Polynesian family, it's been hard for us to communicate.
They can be an amazing family and just not be great at communicating.
Not
too
good
yeah.
at communicating.
Yeah.
You know, very passive aggressive with older, you know, with elder people.
Yeah.
You know, me with my older brother and him with the older sibling, you know what I mean? The line of communication wasn't two ways.
Yeah.
It was one way.
It was one dimensional.
One dimensional, you know, and I think over the last little bit, we've been able to open up the other communication line and been able to talk, which has been really beneficial for our family, to evolve that way and show love in different ways of what we learned and what we were programmed and conditioned to love. And my family is amazing, my brothers and sisters, and my parents. My dad's a hardworking guy, been a bus driver his whole life, or my whole life, and raised 8 kids off of a bus driver salary. Mm-hmm. And never missed a football game, never missed a basketball game, and was a coach. And now being a father myself, I can understand that sacrifice of time and the love I see from that, of the time that he's given me as a son.
So he modeled for you a whole lot of things. Consistency equals safety and structure,
exactly.
Equals love. Like,
yeah.
you can have $1 million paying job, but if you don't go to work every day, yeah. You're not going to be employed too long, right?
Yeah, exactly. And looking back, I see that. I thought for some reason I had this conception that love was, objects that I was given. And looking back, I realized, the time that I was given from my father was more important than anything I could have been given materially. And I'm grateful for that. And then, my wife, she's just incredible. There's nothing I can say to do her justice. Just the strength. I think any spouse that has someone that has gone through addiction, any form, is strong. And
they deserve a trophy or something.
They deserve more.
Yeah. Like, what is it?
But she's just amazing. And throughout this whole time of her putting up boundaries and just being real, I believe that my kids were there that haven't come yet. And I just had a daughter. And I believe
congratulations.
That, thank you. And I believe that my daughter was there to strengthen my wife during these past couple of years of dark times. And I believe that the other kids that I have that are going to come, were with me in that room. But she's amazing. And we've grown so much as a couple these last 2 years. And she's
probably feeling so much more free.
So much more free.
Yeah. Like, she doesn't have to hold on to all the secrets and.
Exactly. And she talks about it all the time, and she's able to, because we've opened up about our story, help other wives that are going through this.
Like, yeah, there's so many wives
thing.
Out there that are struggling and keeping it all on tight lip,
exactly.
Especially, you get a religious dominated area and environment, you mm-hmm. think like, oh, you get lots of great support. It's true, but you also get a lot more reason to keep it a secret.
Yeah. Exactly. And especially with social media now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that's what drove my wife a lot during this dark period was her sadness and comparing her life to people's pictures, and being like, man, I'm not made. We're not going to the zoo. We're not doing these things. We're not having fun like they look like, and
created so much more pain.
Yeah. So much more pain. And now we, there's a quote that Alema has up in his office. This is, comparison is the thief of joy.
That's a good one.
Yeah, and me and my wife have that up in our house. We're like, man, we let's just be happy with where we're at now, and let's not look at what so and so's doing, or what fullback is making that I played against.
You were starting over, and now they're balling.
Yeah. just being grateful for where I'm at now, and the trials that I face now, and I'm grateful for that.
Yeah, I was just thinking the same thing. Go ahead, tell him what you're thinking, Ken.
No, I love what he just said. Like, that is so true. Because, when my girl, she said, it's crazy how you just said it. Like, she looks at the pictures on Instagram, seeing other couples and stuff like that, and she's like, I wish we could do that. And then what you just said, man, and I tell her all the time, there's no need to compare, you just hit, man, it's just crazy, man. Like,
well,
he's hitting everything.
It's so
on the
human
nail.
To compare.
Right.
Yeah.
Right? Like, because how do we evolve? How, in competition, it's like, right, where's the measuring stick?
Right.
Problem is with social media now, specifically, and I'm not downing, I'm not an anti-social media person or like that, but like something like Instagram where the filters and everything like that, it's made to, you know, mm-hmm. for the betterment of your moment, to make it look as great as possible. Mm-hmm. But then you take that natural human element of like, man, like, how do I know if I'm doing good? Let me measure myself up against other people mm-hmm. that are putting in a whole lot of time to look like they're doing good. Yeah. Well, where some people just like, I don't have the energy to try to make my life look that yeah. great, but they still want to look at other people's lives.
Exactly. Yeah.
That comparison, I like that. The comparison is, what was
the
that?
The thief of joy.
The thief of joy.
Comparison is the thief of joy.
Well, I'll tell you what, anyone listening to this podcast, the good thing about what you just talked about today on the radio show and right now is like, if you compare your struggles to what Stanley's been talking about, his struggles, that's the type of comparison that's not going to take away your joy. In fact, what it's going to do is you're going to compare him to what you're going through. You're going to relate. Mm-hmm. Right? The root of the word relationship is relate. Right? Someone's got to go first, though. Someone's got to let you know what they're going through to even see that you can relate mm-hmm. with that person. So, Stanley, I hope you enjoyed time on the show. In fact, instead of just saying, I hope, man, what was it like for you tonight, man? You know, was it all right for a Tuesday night?
Oh, man, it was awesome.
Club's going up on a Tuesday. So, what were some of the things that you just like, I don't know, that you felt just being here tonight?
I felt a lot of love, man. And if my story can help anybody, you know, one person, I'm grateful that I'm alive for that, you know, to create that ripple effect that will go on for generations if someone could get help. And it's never easy to share my story and to become vulnerable like this, but it's so rewarding, you know, to get out there and tell it and just feel connection, like you say, because that's like Brene Brown says, man, that's where connection comes from, being vulnerable and telling my story.
Yeah, we have a saying, quit tripping, you know, kryptonite to depression, kryptonite to addiction is connection. And the best suicide prevention is connection. You know, I mean, there's no perfect science, but, you know, if you got a couple people to talk about your struggles with, you're less likely to go down the rabbit hole.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're isolated, you're all alone, well then, you know, the odds are against you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm glad you're part of the, by the way, I don't know if you knew this, but you're part of the Quit Tripping family now. We've adopted you.
I'm happy. Finally.
We had room for one more Tongan. He took up a lot of the space. Hey, technically supposed to be four, but he took a...
I'll be Maori, because that's my...
Oh, that's true. That's true. And you have gotten ripped up lately, too,
he's,
man.
He's so ripped.
Are you about to do a show, man? About to do a show? MPC?
I'm just trying to be healthy. Just trying to be healthy, man.
I always said, for a second, I thought of you in the Speedo. That's bad.
No, man. Take that picture out of your mind.
At least you already the spray tan. You're already tan, you know?
Right.
Right. Stanley, thanks so much for coming tonight. Feces, did you have a good time, man?
It was awesome, man. This is the first time I've been on a broadcast, so I didn't know what to expect. But just to hear the story and to have him be as courageous as he was and is, you know, is something that really gives me more desire.
Heck yeah.
To be, you know, the counselor and the therapist that can be out there on the front lines, you know, helping individuals and families. And stuff.
Makes you want to go back to work, yeah. Huh? Like, man, there's so much work to be done, right?
Big time.
You know, I want to end it with, we have, you know, and I'd really like to invite you, if you could please come to one of the groups.
I would love to.
Night with the teams. Yeah. In fact, we got a group down in Utah County in Pleasant Grove.
Yeah, I heard, yeah.
Yeah, so really want you to come down to one of our groups, and we have a saying at the end of every single group that we end our podcast tonight is, and that saying is, let's say whatever we talked about, that let's say someone confessed that they're struggling with pornography addiction, someone confessed that they're struggling with self-harm, drug addiction, family drama, whatever it may be. Excuse me. What we like to say is we say depression, anxiety, drug addictions, pornography, bullying, self-harm, family drama, all these things are not who you are. Unfortunately, it may be what you have to go through. So thanks for coming and hanging out with us so you don't have to go through it alone. Plain and simple.
Love it.
So
awesome.
Yeah, I got an official invite. Hopefully you like the Stan socks. And yeah, man. Look forward to having you back. And we got some things coming up in the future, Polynesian related stuff like that, mm-hmm. some other stuff that we're working on that we'd like to have you be a part of it. We definitely feel that your influence could definitely touch a lot more people. So don't be surprised you get another call from the bat phone. If the if the please come help us out.
Yeah.
Phone call comes.
I'll change my number.
Okay. That's right. I'll stalk you on social media. We have an intern stalker, Brandon. Can you go ahead? And we need to find anyone. Brandon will find him.
Oh, man.
All right, you guys. Thank you very much. Quit Tripping After Party. See you next week. And thanks as always.